The next thing we're going to show is that if we have a linear transformation L, then if we add several vectors together and then transform them, we get the same result as if we transform the individual vectors first and then add the results of those. It's tempting to say that this is obvious, but this is a wonderful opportunity to do a proof by induction and teach you a little bit about a new proof technique. Proof by induction is extremely important, and as a matter of fact, many of the homework in this week have to do with proof by induction so that you can get some practice with that. When one wants to prove something for general k, where k is a natural number, one often will employ a proof by induction. What I'm going to do is I'm going to give you the proof by induction for the specific lemma that we just discussed, this one right here. And then I will explain why that proof actually works. And then you're going to get some practice doing proofs by induction by yourself later. Okay, how do you do a proof by induction? Well, we're going to start with a base case, k equals 1. Okay, now what do you get if you have k equals 1? If we go back to this statement right here, when k is equal to 1, we only have v0. All of these other ones go away. So all we need to show is that L of v0 is equal to L of v0. Ah, but that's easy. Okay, let's move back over here. So we can simply say that's trivially true by the insight that we just made. The next thing you do is you do the inductive step. And this gets a little bit confusing because some people get the impression that we're assuming the result and then use it to prove the result and that that's wrong. However, that's not quite the case. What we're saying here is that the result is true for some little k equal big k, where k is greater than or equal to 1. And if it's true for k equals big k, this result right here, that was the result in the lemma, then we're going to use that to prove that it's also true for little k equal to big k plus 1. This is called the inductive step, and the fact that you're assuming that it's true for k equals big k is called the inductive hypothesis, for which we use the shorthand IH. All right, how does this work? Here goes the proof. This is what we want to prove. That's this result right here. Now, we can expose one extra term. Okay, so all we're doing here is we're saying, well, we've got this dot, dot, dot there. Let's actually expose that previous term as well here. And then what we do is we say, well, we can put some parentheses around these vectors right here. Now, notice that this here is also a vector. We think of this now as one vector that consists of adding the previous vectors together plus one more vector. Now we know that L is a linear transformation, so we know that you can add first and then transform, or you can transform first and then add, and that leaves you with this result. Now, this we recognize as being part of our inductive hypothesis, and our inductive hypothesis says that that part is equal to this right here. So we can invoke the inductive hypothesis and say this is equal to that. All right. Well, notice that that's exactly what we were trying to prove, so we're done. And then you need to do one more thing. You need to say, by the principle of mathematical induction, the result holds for all k. Now, how does this work? The idea is as follows. We prove it for the base case k equals 1. So we know that L of v0 is equal to L of v0. Now that's pretty obvious. The inductive step says that if it's true for k equals 1, so here we choose our big k to be 1, then it's also true for k equals k plus 1, which is 2. So if it's true for k equals 1, then it's true for k equals 2. But we know that it's true for k equals 1. That was the base case. So therefore, we know that it's also true for k equals 2. And therefore, we know that this here is true as well. Our inductive step says, if it's true for k equals 2, then it's also true for k equals 3. But we know it's true for k equals 2. We've just concluded that right here. So therefore, we know it's true for k equals 3. And so forth, and this way, you can argue that it's true for all k greater than or equal to 1. It's sort of like dominoes. You push over the first one, that's the base case, and then the rest of them fall in place.